So how about everybody just come and just sit down? Again, I've just been feeling really strong. You know, I think we're going to do celebration. Hey, Robbie, are we doing celebration? Okay, we're doing some celebration tonight. But we want to get ready, right? So how about you come and sit down? Because I really felt like the Lord was walking through the crowd. And if you know, if you were standing in there and all of a sudden you actually saw the living God stand before you, you'd be celebrating, wouldn't you? So I just want to welcome you all. It's been a wonderful day and there's so much more. So we just have a few announcements. So if you can all just go turn to your neighbor and go shh. Oh, good.
Very good. Just a couple of things. When we have ministry tonight, there is a very good possibility that we're going to be asking some of you to move to a different place for ministry. So if you could listen to me about this one. Those of you underneath the flags, wave your hands. Very good. We're going to have you folks stack your chairs flat, not leaning against the wall, but flat, 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 like that, about 30 high. Put them against the wall. And you folks are going to stay right in that area, but you're going to need to stack them and put the chairs the same way, like not back and forwards, and they'll stack real neat and they won't fall over. So you folks are going to be there. You folks over here, we're going to have you go underneath that side as well. The folks in the back, wave your hands on the plastic chairs. Great. Same thing for you folks. When ministry takes place, if you could take your chairs either side, lay them flat on the floor, 30 high, no leaning against the walls, just nice and flat like that. And you folks are going to stay at the back for ministry as well. The folks in this section here and this section here, we are probably going to have you folks go upstairs into the overflow rooms where we have lots and lots of space. So there's room for 600 people upstairs. So we'll probably have you folks go upstairs. That means you'll need to take your... ladies, make sure you take your purses with you. Don't leave them here. And the folks in the far section over here, wave your hands. Great. You folks over there, we'll probably have you folks join these ones at the back underneath the area over there. So that's the tentative plan. You'll need to hear how things are going when we get there. All right, we have a number of different sort of blanket towel kind of things. People are always, do you know what people do? They come and they steal our throw cloths. You know, when people are lying on the floor and you want to cover them up. And so, anyways, so we thought if people like them so much, maybe they'll like them better if they have something a little bit nicer on. And so these are really nice and warm, especially if you're soaking. These are designed for that. There's a number of different colors. There's green as well. And there's even pillows if people like to do that kind of thing. And there's some that say, catch the fire, soaking prayer centers. So there's a number of people that have soaking prayer centers, so that's what that's for as well. So just to let you know, you don't need to steal our stuff, you can get your own. Are you ready to have a great night tonight, friends? It's going to be... We are planning to do some healing ministry at some point. I know that Bob Jones, who's going to be preaching tonight, is planning to be breaking some curses. He's got a whole list of things that we were just talking over beforehand, of things that he's already felt in the spirit realm to pray through. Very specific things, life-giving things. So I think tonight's going to be a great ministry night. So stand up. Stand up. Grab one person's hand. Can you do that? Grab someone close to you. Do you know what night tonight is? How many of you know what night tonight is, other than Thursday night? Sorry? Here's what tonight is. On the Jewish calendar, Pentecost will start as soon as the sun goes down. So grab someone's hand. Grab someone's hand and say, Holy Spirit, come for me, come for my friend, fill me up, fill my friend. We'd like more of the Holy Spirit, like more of the Holy Spirit. Come, Daddy, fill us up more.
All right, who here recognizes that we're breaking through into something new this week? That we're breaking through into something amazing this week? That we're getting somewhere that we haven't necessarily been before? That we're feeling something that we haven't necessarily felt before? Seeing something that we haven't seen before? Hearing a sound that we haven't heard before? I'm not just talking about music, because that's what I do. I'm talking about sounds that we hear, sounds from heaven, from the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is coming down. That is His will. It is His will for the kingdom to come down on earth. And that's our cry. God, that's our cry tonight. Our cry is for Your kingdom to come down tonight. For Your kingdom to come down tonight. God, let Your will be done. Let Your kingdom come and Your will be done. Here in this place tonight, God. Here in this place tonight, God. There's a song that everyone can sing. There's a prayer that everyone can bring. Feel the music, 'cause it's time to dance. People all across the world with a heartbeat for holiness. Feel His pleasure. We are God's romance. Hear the sound, let it shake the ground. Now's the time for the saints to sing. There's a race that everyone can win. Leave your sadness, it's our time to dance. Everyone let out your praise. People with their hearts ablaze. We found Jesus, He's our great romance. Hear the sound, let it shake the ground. Now's the time for the saints to shine. Everyone, here is the kingdom come. Here is the God who saves the day. Yeah, we will.
cry out, holy is the Lord. We'll never stop crying for the Lord. Holy is the Lord. We lift you high tonight, Lord.
Thank you for all you are. Oh,
are good. You are good. And I will sing your praises, oh Lord, oh Lord. And I will shout it out. You are good. Everything we've done, you managed to pull us through, God. You didn't let us stay behind, but you left the 99 for the one. You must have left the 99 a lot of times for me. Come to save me time and time again. You rescue me, you saved me, you brought me home. You rescue me, you saved me, brought me home. To rescue me, you saved me. Oh, you brought me home. How can I thank you, Lord, for opening up my eyes to see all you've done? How can I thank you, Lord, for opening up my ears so I can hear you? He's calling you deeper. He's calling you deeper. He's calling you deeper. Lead us into you. 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 Just cry out, lead me into you. Lead me into you. Lead me into you. Lead me into you. Lord, lead me into you. Lead me into you. Lead me into you. Lead me into you. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. Let your your will be done let your kingdom come. And your will be done here on earth. Here on earth, as it is in heaven. Here on earth, let your kingdom come, let your will be done, let your kingdom come, let your will be done here in
situations in your life, in your home, in your churches, in your cities, in your countries, I feel right now just to start to cry out, just cry out, just cry out that the kingdom of God would come, that the will of God would be done. Because when His kingdom falls, when His kingdom falls, nothing else matters. Nothing else matters. Nothing can stand against your kingdom, God. Nothing can stand against your kingdom, God. We cry out for you, O Lord. We cry out for you, O Lord. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. God, here on earth, O Lord. Let your kingdom come. God, let your will be done. Here on earth. As it is in heaven. Don't stop crying out. Don't stop crying out. Lord, here on earth. Here on earth, let your kingdom come. Let your kingdom come. Let your kingdom come. Let your kingdom come. I feel like it's time to start dancing on injustice. I feel like it's time to start stomping out what the enemy had in plan. I really think it's time to just stand. Time to stand in who we are as the King of Kings' children. As the children of the King of Kings. Time to know who we are. Time to walk in who we are. Time to run in who we are. Time to know who we are. Come on, let's dance, let's dance, let's dance. We'll be right back.
God has given us, the heart that He's placed inside of us, that thing that beats in us so much that's just time to shine. It's time to let that out. It's time to recognize who you are. It's time to recognize that you have it in you, that you have it in you to go out into the world. You have it in you to call forth the kingdom of God and let it come down and just watch it come down. It is God, that's our cry tonight. Lord, that your kingdom would come down. That your kingdom would come out on all the situations that we have facing us, God. On all the areas of our lives that we have facing us, God. That we don't know how we're going to get over, God. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. Kingdom come, Lord. Let it come. 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 Churches, Lord, right now, while we're not in them, Lord, let your kingdom fall down. So this Sunday is a little reckless in our homes, oh Lord, let your kingdom rain down. On our finances, Lord, let your kingdom rain down. Let your kingdom rain down. Lord, on our health tonight, on our health, oh Lord, let your kingdom rain down. Let your kingdom rain down. On the wars around the world, oh God, your kingdom reign now. Let your will be done, oh Lord. Right here, right now, let your kingdom, let your kingdom go. Right here, right now, right here, right now, right here, right now, right here, right now, Lord, right here, right now, right here, right now, right here, right now, right here, right now, Lord, right here. Right now, right here, 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 right now, oh right here, right now, let's cry out, right here, right now, Lord, let your kingdom come, let your kingdom come. Let your kingdom come, let your kingdom come, Lord, right here, Lord, right now, Lord, right here, Lord, right now, Lord, let your kingdom come, let your will be done, right here, right now, right here, right now, right here, right now, right here. Right now, Lord, right here and right now, Lord, let your kingdom come. Let your kingdom come, Lord. Let your kingdom come, Lord. Let your kingdom come, Lord. Let your kingdom come. And I exalt thee, and I exalt thee, and I exalt thee. Oh, Lord, lift you high, oh Lord, and I
sing Jesus, precious Jesus. Jesus, you're my precious Jesus, the King.
Just lift his name up right now. Just begin to worship him. Say his name out loud. Sing in the spirit. Worship him. Do whatever you need to do. Just lift him up. Jesus. Jesus. Father, would you send your spirit into this place. As the sun goes down, we begin Pentecost. We remember the day that you sent your Holy Spirit, filled your disciples again, filled your people. Father, would you send your Spirit again tonight? Father, we welcome all of your ministering spirits to be here as well. We welcome the angels. Just seen this picture of, we don't have a balcony in here, but it was just like there's a balcony and there's these trumpeters all the way around, and it's just these angels declaring the entrance of the King. Father, we welcome your presence. We welcome you to come. Welcome you to come. Welcome you to come. Welcome you to come. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Come, Holy Spirit. Worship you. Bless you, Daddy. Thank you, Father. Boom. You know, we want to minister physical healing tonight. And one of the things that the Father loves to do is to heal his children. And Father, we're asking that you begin to do that right now for every person in this room that has sickness, that has pain. Holy Spirit, would you begin to just move from one side to the other, go up and down the rows, send your ministering spirits in and out of the rows, begin to minister to us. Holy Spirit, come. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Welcome you, Holy Spirit. Welcome you, Holy Spirit. If you have pain in your body, I want you just to not focus on your pain, but focus on your big God. Just allow his Spirit to begin to touch you and to fill you. Holy Spirit, would you come? Would you come? Those of you that have pain or sickness in your body, could you put your hand up real quick, just right where you are? Folks, if you're around someone that has their hand up, put your hand on their shoulder right now. Holy Spirit, come. 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 I just felt God saying, boo. Just sort of scaring all the demonic that's been on you and lifting it off. And Father, we just say boo to every curse that's on people in terms of their physical problems, sicknesses, diseases. We welcome the Holy Spirit, the wonderful Holy Spirit, to come into our bodies, replace every sickness with his presence, with his peace. Everything to be lifted off of you right now. Lifted off of you right now. Now just keep focusing, and those of you that are being ministered to, just keep going. In the workshop that I was leading this afternoon, we did some stretching for people. And one of the things that we did was talked about how Jesus kept referring to how he did things, but he only did what he saw, he only did what he was taught, he only did what he heard. And so he functioned very much in the revelatory sense. He was very aware of what the Father wanted and just went ahead and did it. And one of the things that we did was we had everyone who had sickness or pain, and there was well over 100 people that came and stood at the front, in front of the rest of us. And then the people in the chairs who were relatively healthy, our job was to scan the people, pick one of them that the Holy Spirit was leading us to, and then ask the Holy Spirit, what sickness do they have? And just go out on a limb and say, Holy Spirit, speak to me. What sickness do they have? Give me some sort of revelation. And so this was a stretch, I think, for most people. And then it was go to that person and ask them if that's what they have. And about 70% of the people were right. It was amazing. Because how many thousands of sicknesses are there? And they went and said, you know, this is what I feel you have. And 70% of the people the first time around, that's exactly what they had. And so we had a fun time doing that. And then I gave the people some homework. I said, when we have our soaking time, ask the Holy Spirit for the meeting tonight. What's going on? And so I've got all sorts of stuff that people had dreams, maybe not dreams, revelations, visions. And I know that the professionals here can do this kind of stuff, but this is a place to practice for others as well. So I'm just going to read some of these things out. And if you're here, just wave your hand real fast. Real fast? Is that the right word? Violently. A woman with brown hair wearing a brown Indian cotton shirt or a tunic that has a blue trim on it, and you have a stomach problem. Are you here? Wave if you're here. Lady with a stomach problem, you're wearing, the person thought you had long hair, and you were wearing a cotton shirt with blue trim. Anyone match that description? Wave, if I'm not seeing someone, is there someone that matches that? Where? Everyone's pointing somewhere. By the door. But she has short hair, apparently. That's all right. That's pretty close. This is practice. Just put your hands on her. Actually, push your stomach, ma'am, and see if you still got the pain. Is the pain still there? Yes or no? Is the pain still there? Yes or no? She's saying no. Okay, very good. That one's done. A lady with neck problems, neck and left shoulder pain. Every time you go to minister to someone, it gets worse for you. Is that Carol?
Yeah.
Well, you can read the rest of it then. Give that to Carol. There's more. They feel that they had the cause of it as well. I won't get into that. Alrighty. Was there more ladies that have shoulder and neck problems, and when you go to minister, it gets worse? Other ladies as well? Like, go like this if that's you, so we can see you. Okay, there's a couple over here, over here. Just put your hands on those folks as well. Actually, check your neck first of all and see if it's bad. And if it's bad, then have the people around you pray. A lady who struggles with diabetes and obesity. Is there a lady that's in that place today where these are battles that you face? Wave your hands. Diabetes and obesity, okay? See a lady over here? Anyone else? Okay, over here as well. Just have your friends just pray with you. That'd be all right? Just pray for that lady. A man who has it says penetrating injury to his eye, probably his right eye. Is there someone that has an injury in your right eye? A man. Wave. You have pain in your right eye. Well, we'll get you. Just pray for this guy in the orange over there. Over, someone's pointing over here, somewhere, over here, over here, over here. Everyone's pointing. Okay, there you are, back there. Great. Do you still have the problem? Is there still pain? Or is it gone? It's still there? Okay. Stand up. The people around you, just lay hands on him. Let me do a few more. Is there a lady that was in a car accident and you broke your back in the car accident? Broke your back in a car accident. Where are you? Broke your back? Over here? Okay. Do you still have pain in your back right now? No, it's gone. Okay, good. Here's one. A lady and probably wearing a red shirt, has lung cancer and lymph node cancer. Is that true of anyone? A lady, lung cancer, lymph node cancer. Are you here? Wave your hands. Wave your hands. Lung cancer, lady with lung cancer, wave your hands. Yes, no? Yes, no? Is there a man that has lung cancer? Yes, no? Okay. We're practicing. We got a whole bunch. Let me do a couple more here. Well, one lady really stepped out because I asked people to say things like ask the Holy Spirit what were their names and those kind of things. And this one is saying that she thinks there's a lady named Moira from South Africa and has a hip problem. Is there a lady named Moira, hip problem, from South Africa? Wave your hand. Wave your hand. Is there a lady from South Africa, maybe your name's not Moira, but you've got hip problems? South African lady? I can't tell who's waving to friends and who's waving at me. Well, you know what? Sandra's just saying there's people on the internet that are watching as well. And so, ma'am, if you're in South Africa right now, I'd get you to just check your hip because there's a very good chance that that's been done. Here's what I'd like you to do, friends. Stand up again. Stand up. You gave up way too soon. You became observers. Don't become observers. Be participants. If you have pain or sickness in your body, if you'd stood up the first time, can you check yourself and see if you're better? If you already were standing and people around you were praying, wave your hand if you are better. Wave your hand. Wave your hand. Okay, that's not near enough. Not near enough. So let's do it again. If you still have pain, still have sickness, hand up. Hand up. Still have pain, still have sickness. Okay, people around them, find these people. Let's lay hands on them. Let's welcome the Holy Spirit to come. I'd like you to say this prayer with me. My healing belongs to me because of what Jesus has done. I receive my healing now in Jesus' name. Now just let that come. Let healing come to you right now. Father, we're asking that you'd come and lift off whatever the root cause is, whether it was an accident, whether it was, just all sorts of different reasons why pain comes and sickness comes. Father, we just lift it off of God's people in the name of Jesus. We lift it off of you right now. And we say, receive a gift of God from your Heavenly Father. Receive the gift from your Heavenly Father. Come, 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 come. Come, Daddy. Love up on your people. Love up on your people right now.
And Father, I just ask right now that you would just, if you're suffering anxiety attacks, is there anybody here? If that's you, just put your, okay, the people around, can you just pray for this lady? But Father, I just ask right now that those that suffer with anxiety attacks, Lord, we just give it to Jesus. We give him all our frustrations and our fears and our pains and our worries and all those things. And Jesus paid the price for those things. So can you give them back? Can you just give it to him instead of holding it? Whoa! And so, Father, we just release all those fears and all those anxieties. We release them back to you. We release them back to your son. And, Father, we give you all the glory and all the praise for your healing. Thank you, Father.
Come, Holy Spirit. Keep coming. Just pray for him. Okay, I'd like you to check yourself. Wiggle around, move, push. Do something you couldn't do before. How many of you are feeling better? Wave your hands. Keep waving. Okay, this is much, much better. Good. How many of you, something very dramatic has just happened? Very dramatic. Very dramatic. Just happened. Like something you couldn't, this is big time. God just done something really good. Wave your hand, something big. I'd like to have a couple of people come up and give testimony. That's what we're saying. Where's those folks? If something really good has happened, run up to the front real quick. Can you do that? I heard that there's a lady here that you had some sort of, I think, a car accident a few years ago, and your foot was amputated at the knee and your leg has been growing and has grown about a foot. Whereabouts are you? Is that lady here? lady whose leg was amputated and it's growing. Is that lady here tonight? Where is she? Yes? No? Where is she? Just get her to come on up here. Get her to come up. Come, Holy Spirit.
Yep. There's all sorts of people here.
Is the lady here with the leg that's growing back? Is she coming? Okay, there she is. Yep. Okay, how about those of you in the front? If you could go back to your seat, would that be all right so we can... We're just going to talk to this lady and find out what God's doing. Okay, we'll just come on over here. Okay. Yep, just a minute. Okay. Folks, give me your attention here. Come on up here. We're just praying for this lady. She's one of the people that we were just praying for. And what was your problem before?
I had a severe bone spur on the outer part of my heel, and I couldn't put any weight on that side of my foot, and I can put all of my weight on that right now.
So there's nothing wrong anymore?
No pain.
That's really good.
Can you take a little jog over here and just see how that is? Okay, come back. Any pain at all? Not at all. It's
no
very
pain.
Good.
No,
okay.
No,
wonderful. No. Very, very good. Okay. Now, this lady right down here, if you can see this lady. Am I right that were you in a car accident?
Yes, sir. I was killed in an accident. I was dead in the morgue. God brought me back twice. This is my 12th creating miracle to my body. Okay. I had a broken femur at the hip. 3 inches. I was off at the kneecap.
So they amputated your leg at your kneecap?
To this point, the femur came in instantly, got a brand new knee, 3 inches from the ankle. All the muscles were in from my foot. The medical doctor says my foot will be coming soon.
So you are 3 inches away from the ankle now? And you're wearing a prosthetic, obviously. So do you want to show us?
No problem.
Okay, come on up here. Go on up the stairs over here. How many of you have never seen a leg that's grown back? I've never seen one. So she said if she sits down, she can roll up her trouser leg and show us this. So have a seat here. So your leg, okay. Okay, now how far, where does your leg start? Where does the new leg start? You're right down to here now? You're right down to there now on the inside of this. 3 inches from your ankle, and they amputated right here at the knee. Is that right?
The kneecap.
That was very, very good. And she's written a little booklet that was sent to me before. And it continues to grow. Is that right?
Yes, sir. This is creating miracles for the body of Christ. I'm symbiotic. I got a new heart, a new brain. I was in the morgue. Come back from the dead twice. The little book has all the medically documented.
Yep. Okay.
So this is what I'm the forerunner of the body of Christ. As you said, as your father and children, we come together. Everyone's going to walk in divine healing and creating miracles.
Amen, amen. Very, very good. So this is going to be a museum piece pretty soon. That's quite interesting, isn't it? Very, very good. Excellent.
Thank you.
How many of you need that kind of miracle in your body? Like, you need a big miracle. Like, we're talking, you've got cancers, you've got major problems. Stand up. Can we do that? Stand up. Your God is able. Did you know that? Your God calls himself the God who heals you. God who heals you. So the folks that are standing, we're saying that you need a major miracle in your body. Father, would you come? Just close your eyes. Father, these are the folks that have things like cancer. They have tumors. They have issues in their body where the doctors probably have said, this is a sickness unto death. And Father, we are here in the name of Jesus to declare that the doctors are not necessarily the final, they are not the final word. They're not the final say. And Father, we bless doctors. We thank you for them. But Father, we thank you that you are the final word on every person's life, every sickness, every disease. And Daddy, we're asking that you would do miracles in the lives of these men and women. Father, you do creative things in their lives. Father, we're asking that you bring down organs from heaven, from the storage banks in heaven, put them into these people. Father, that you give new eyes, new ears, new body parts, whatever those body parts would be. Holy Spirit, we thank you. We welcome you to come, Daddy. We welcome you to come. Life. Yeah. Life in the name of Jesus into each one of you. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. We welcome you, Jesus. We welcome you.
Can we just have the soaking school? Do you want them now? No, we don't want the soaking school. Sorry. Okay. We want Gord.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. Are you having fun? God's good, isn't he? Well, I'm Gordon Harris, and my wife and I direct the School of Ministry here at TACF. It's always quite fun to have that roar from the side. At the School of Ministry, we really are about experiencing God's love and then being equipped to give that love away, just as Jesus was. And that's our heart, if you could boil it down into a nutshell. And we've had many, many, many people go through the school in the last several years. I want to just run a clip here, a two-minute clip, and you'll see an anonymous person on their journey through the school. So do you want to run that clip?
And this is Gordon.
Together we direct TACF School of Ministry.
Our dream for you guys would be that you would know who you are, know what you're called to do, and then get out there and do it.
So come on, live the adventure and change the world.
At the school, our dance and graphic design, they're not just things that we do, but they're more like a culture that we use to express our love to God.
We don't leave the school and go home and live the same as before. We leave with the love for the King,
knowing who we are in Him, and nothing will ever be the same again.
The School of Ministry, the main part of our program, there are three modules for people between 18 and 35 years of age. The first one is School of the Heart, which has been running since 1995. And in this module, we're really attempting to go after heart issues and quickly get young people trained up and out there doing the stuff. In the Bible School, which is the second module, we're trying to dig them deeper into the Word, but not ignore the Spirit and all that. We really want a marriage of the Spirit and the Word. And in the Worship School, which is the third young person's module, I think they've had a good time in that worship module. It's really about exploring the passion for worship and intimacy. And I think all of us, especially tonight with what's been going on, you can kind of get a sense of what that's like. We also have a short module, 2-3 week module for people who are a little bit outside that age range. Anybody here outside that age range? Yeah, me too. There is no, you can be 99 and that would be all right to come. And this is Leader School of Ministry, and it actually compresses down the core kind of items that we have in the school. All of the students that come through the School of Ministry, including in the youth modules, have to go through this, what we call it actually, core value module. And it is hearing God's voice in the prophetic as well, the Father heart of God, and also healing life's hurts. And these are really amazing things. If you talk to somebody who's ever been to one of these modules, they'll just tell you it's fantastic. We're also, we usually have something else going on as well during the year, once or twice a year. I think this January we're exploring maybe doing a kind of a business module where people who have been in ministry but actually need that kind of equipping. Steve, you're going to take it, aren't you? Yeah, there we go. So an endorsement right there. We're not sure what we're going to call it, but if you want to keep up to date on what we're doing, you're thinking about coming to one of our modules, just look us up on the web under tacf.org and School of Ministry. So have a fun time.
Thank you, Gordon. The school has had thousands of young adults that have come. If you're from a church that someone's come to the School of Ministry, can I get you to wave your hand? Did they have a good time? Did they come back changed? Yes? No? Yes? Yes? Thank you. You know what? People are a little quiet tonight, aren't you? Stand up. Stand up. You know that it's sundown. How many of you remember what that means? It's the beginning of Pentecost when the sun goes down, so that's right now. Grab someone's hand. Grab someone's hand. Say to them, you need more of the Holy Spirit. Fill them up. Fill them up, Daddy. Would you come and visit us again? Visit us again. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Welcome you. Spirit of God, come. Okay. Turn around and touch someone else on the shoulder that's close to you. Fill them up. More, Daddy. More of your Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Okay, find one more person. One more person. Say, Happy Pentecost Day. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Get some more. Get some more. Get some more. Okay, you may be seated. Pastor John's going to share with us about our missions offering that we're going to be taking tomorrow night.
Great. Thank you, Steve. Oh, come on. Just give somebody some more out there. Just listen, he said, freely you have received, so freely give. That's what we decided here a long time ago. Walk in God's love and then give it away. Walk in it. Get filled with it. Overflow with it. And then give it away. By the way, in terms of some of the product tonight, this whole set on DVD and on CD, you can order these. And what a resource to take back to show in your home group or your cell or your soaking center, whatever it is, because this is just some amazing stuff that we've already heard from Paul Keith Davis and from Bobby Connor, and it'll be wonderful to hear Bob Jones tonight as well. And all of this stuff is such powerful resource to help you get to where you want to go and where you need to go. So take it with you, folks. Such a deal. Okay, every night we open the conference so that the local people from Toronto and or the surrounding area can come on in and be a part of it. And for that reason, we like to take up offerings in the evening so that they can participate in all of this. All right, so our ushers, are you ready now? Do we have ushers? Can I have the ushers come forward, please, at this time? Let's take a moment and ask the Lord what he would have you to do. And simply, in loving obedience, do what he says. I want you to learn to have fun with finances, okay? How many know that God does not need your 20 bucks? How many know that, right? But he's saying, hey, if you want to learn to be like me, if you want to learn my heart and my values, then you need to learn to be a giver. And as you give, and as you learn to love to give, and as you learn to sow, and sow in faith with expectation, then God will bless you financially. And he wants to do that. It's not a reward, but it's what follows for you desiring your Father's heart. Your Heavenly Father is a giver. Say that with me. My Heavenly Father's a giver. And I want to be like my dad. Now that's it. So now when you need some, okay, so what do? You ask him, Father, what do you want me to do tonight? Just speak to me in Jesus' name. And then I'm going to sow in faith. And I'm going to sow in loving obedience with a big smile on my face. And that's basically it. Now here's the problem for a lot of people. When they ask him, Lord, what do you want me to give? His figure is always a lot higher than what you were thinking about. Very often. And that's where a lot of people choke. But learn to just say, okay, well, if that's what you're saying, I'm going to do it and just see what happens. Steve, how many times have you given only like before you leave the building, it's back to you already? Just had that so many times, it's just amazing. You just did it on Sunday again. Right. Let's bow in prayer. Loving Father, we thank you that you have poured out upon us abundance, abundance, abundance. And we love your kingdom, Lord, and we thank you tonight for the privilege and the opportunity of investing in the kingdom of God, Lord, because we feel it's our family business. And the earth is being filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord. The kingdom of God is taking over the world one soul at a time. We thank you, Lord, that around the world today, perhaps 100,000 souls came to Jesus, maybe more. And we love your kingdom, Lord. May your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Bless this offering in the name of Jesus. Amen. Right. If you're making a check, make it to TACF. Your check will probably have your details. That's good enough for a receipt. If you're giving cash or using credit card, please take an envelope from the seat pocket there behind you. Fill your details in completely, and we'll be sure to send you a tax receipt, both for U.S. and Canadians. Now, you British people and Europeans, you don't do tax receipts. You have a different system over there. We'll be happy to send you a receipt if you like one, but it won't do you any good. But over here, we get a tax credit. Isn't that nice? So there we are. Tomorrow night, I'm going to ask that we just pay a little attention to tomorrow night because it is a special mission offering. Say that with me, mission offering. Every conference, we prayerfully talk about what do we want to sow into for missions. And I mean, we've done leaders' schools in Nigeria with 200 pastors. We've just done so many awesome things because the people of God, just like you, have sown into these mission offerings. And what we want to do tomorrow night is to sow into the ministry of Dan Slade and Gwen, his wife, who are missionaries to the Ukraine and the former Soviet Union. And Dan's been over there lighting fires, you know, for 12 years now. And I tell you what, the fire's blazing, and there's some people over there that are really excited about the Lord. Dan, come on up, and we'll try this one more time, see if we can get Dan to talk. And he keeps yelling, come up higher, you know. And but I want you to hear some of the things that happened. Now, Dan was here the very first night the Spirit fell. And just real soon after that, he was off to the Ukraine. And the next thing we know, he's phoning and saying, John, come over. And, you know, we did all that. But then they had a school of young people, a youth retreat, I guess. And the Holy Spirit fell, do you remember? And things have never been the same.
In 1914, my grandfather, Nikolai Marachenko, walked out of Ukraine by night and slept in the forest by day as he was leaving the country because he wanted to avoid the Tsar's soldiers. And he, arriba. Ha! He moved. He came to Canada. And moved to Saskatchewan. That's the flat place on the other side of the country. The only place where you can watch your dog run away for a week. But anyways. He found a Russian-speaking church there and he became a believer. By this time it's 1920. And he became a believer. And he married the pastor's daughter and had 13 children. Delivered all of them by himself. That's the truth. He always wanted to be a doctor, and he wasn't able to. He became a farmer, so he practiced on his wife. But it was always his heart and vision to go back to Ukraine and to preach the gospel to his family, who he had left there, five brothers and sisters and many relatives. He wasn't able to do that because of the political situation, the Iron Curtain, and he passed away in 1989. And in 1989, I went out to his funeral in Saskatchewan. I came back to Fort Erie, just 2 hours from here, and I had a dream the night that I got back, where I was in a large room with my grandfather, and I was surrounded by him and his children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, just, you know, probably about 200 people in this room. And in the midst of this, this is 2 days after my grandfather's funeral, he walked up, he got up out of the chair, and he walked over to me in the midst of all the relatives, and he laid his hands on me, and he prayed. And I believe that... Hariba! I believe that he transferred that heart, that vision that he had to go back to the former Soviet Union to me. And when we first went there in 92, we were amazed at the openness. Where just on the spur of the moment, a meeting where Riba, Roba, you should see the communists react to this, you know, because the same thing happens there, honestly. Rabba! So we had this meeting, and 600 people showed up just on the spur of the moment in 92. And we gave this invitation after preaching, and 300 of them stood up to accept the Lord. And we thought the interpreter must have made a mistake, you know, because, you know, half the people never stand up to accept the Lord. And we told them all to sit down again, and we explained the gospel really clear, heaven, hell, Jesus, the cross. And we said, whoever wants to become a Christian, stand up. And half of them stood up again. And they came forward, and we gave them Bibles, we explained, we introduced them to the local pastor, and then we said, you can go home now. Now, this is end of November, 92, in an unheated building. There's like two light bulbs. It was cold. We wanted to go. It was cold. We just wanted to go home. We've already been there 3 hours. And when we dismissed them, no one left. No one left. Arriba! And they said, tell us more. And it just broke my heart. And we stayed there for another, I don't know how long, and just shared with them the gospel, the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We went through all the doctrines, and they stood there listening to us. And I knew that night that something special was in this country. Arriba! And so I came home and I told my wife, you know, we just bought a house in Fort Erie, like 6 months before. And I came home and I said to my wife, who was still putting up the borders and the decorations, honey, God's calling us to Ukraine to live 90 miles from Chernobyl. And she wasn't really jumping up and down with joy on that one. But Arriba, the Lord... The Lord moved us over, and we've been there for 12 years, and what John is talking about is in 1998, the Holy Spirit fell at a youth camp, similar to the first night. And I was here the first night that the Holy Spirit fell here. And ever since then, just because of lack of time, we just can't get into it all. But, you know, we've seen the rain come down at our conferences, physical, we've seen, with our physical eyes, we've seen rain. We were in Kyrgyzstan in the former Soviet Union. We've seen the golden city above Kyrgyzstan, above Bishkek. There's now 40 churches connected with our network. We have schools. We have pastors' retreats. We have too many invitations. And the Rabba, the message of grace and the river and the Father's love is exactly what the former Soviet Union needs. And we're just privileged to be there. So, Rabba, we thank you for your prayerful participation and in what we're going to do tomorrow night. So bless you.
Oh, thank you, Dan. Don't go away yet. For the sake of you that weren't here Wednesday afternoon we started, Dan just gets all these prophetic reactions that come upon him, and he blows the trumpet, and he paws the ground, and he shouts Arriba, which means come up higher, and all that kind of stuff. And you know, we've taken offerings before for his ministry, and we built a training center over there in, what's the city again? Kirovograd. And so there's a wonderful training center there operating now, but tomorrow night's offering is going for him.
Ha!
Because what he always does is puts it all back in the ministry, you know? So we want to bless Dan and Gwen. Wouldn't it be nice to give them $50,000 or $60,000 tomorrow night, right? Wouldn't that be great? Because we want them, you know, to buy a house over here and do some stuff like that so that his five kids and his wife are not behind the eight ball after it all. But he just gets lost in God. So let's stretch our hands toward him and bless him and ask your Heavenly Father what you would have you do in tomorrow night's mission offering. Arriba, Dan. Go up higher, brother. You know, the way to go higher is to go lower. How many knew that? So that's what Heidi says, lower still. There you go. Okay. Well, we got one more thing to do before Bob comes, and that is we want to have all the soaking school come on up, all of the 70-plus folks that have been in school since Monday. Can you guys all just make your way up here real quick? And guys, come and help Dan down, because they'll trample him or something if we leave him there. But all of these folks, just come on up here really, really quick. And I just want to let you know that this whole vision of the Soaking Prayer Network is exploding around the world. And the reason for that is because we are giving people an opportunity to get into ministry themselves. It's kind of, you know, some of the old business models that were, you know, ready, aim, fire, and all that kind of stuff. And that's normally the normal way is prepare yourself and then sharpen those skills and then run with it and then go with it. But this is a bit of a different business strategy. This is kind of fire, ready, aim, or fire, 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 or something like that, where people come and it's just get going and just do it, kind of like the bakers in Mozambique. Just get out there and do it and learn as you go, on-the-job training. So come on, guys, quick, 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 run up here, quick. Yes. And we've got people who came all the way from Australia for this. Let me have the Australians give us a wave. Yeah, and they're from all over. Thank you, Faustin. Oh, my goodness, look at them all. They're from the United Kingdom, USA, from Malaysia, the Netherlands, New Zealand, South Africa, Sweden, Canada, Australia. Oh, Japan. And these are going to start soaking centers. I don't think I've ever seen it take so long for them all to come up on the platform, Carol. Come on, guys. Run, run, run. That's it. Pack in all the way over. Now listen, when you come down to the front, use both stairs, right? Just you guys go that way, you guys go that way. That would speed it up a little bit. Another row, come on. Now, just while they're coming, I want to just take a couple of minutes before this graduation and speak to Soaking Prayer Center leaders. And how many in the audience are already leading one of our Soaking Prayer Centers? Give me a violent wave right now. Look at them all. And there's a whole bunch more of you that are watching right now live on the internet, and we want to say hi to you guys. And Carol, this is actually a prophetic conference. And I feel that this whole concept here, this whole idea, has such a prophetic edge because people are getting in ministry. You know how reluctant we were.
I know.
Well,
oh, I don't know whether we can do it. Yeah,
whatever.
I know.
Carol, to say, how can I be a pastor's wife? I can't sing and
I can't play the piano.
So, you know. And we had a friend, David Campbell, who said, but you can arrange flowers. So that should have qualified you right there.
That qualified me right there.
But anyway, we want to just say to people that are interested in getting into ministry, this is fantastic, because we'll put all of our resources behind it. We have training schools like this one that you see. We have weekends that go on near you. We have leader schools, either a week long or 3 weeks long, where you can come and get your heart healed and get some values. And what would you say to people?
Oh, I mean, it's just amazing. Oh, people are transformed when they come and they get their hearts healed, they get empowered. And not only that, when they start a soaking center, all of a sudden, now they're really interested in learning how to minister to people. You know, if somebody's, you know, crying and there's all kinds of wounds or there's demons coming out, all of a sudden, they want to know what to do. And so that's what the training's all about. It's sort of, you know, you've got a real hunger once God starts using you and you want to learn more. So we just welcome you to come and learn and go.
Yeah. So all of these folks, we have over 70 people that are graduating from this. And most of them have said, we're going to go home and we're going to start something either in our churches or in our homes, because we want to see the fire of God's presence burning in our community. And I want you to understand that the prophecy of God is that it shall come to pass in the last days, I'll pour out my spirit on all flesh. Did you hear that, Dan?
Well,
all flesh.
Shoot.
Go higher. It's over there in Russia and Ukraine and the former Soviet Union. The whole earth to be full of his glory.
Mm.
And one more thing. This coming September, the end of September, we have our second annual soaking conference, where it's all about come into the glory of God. Last year we had an amazing time with Heidi Baker, Ed Piorek, and all of us. It was just a wonderful, wonderful thing. And June, is it right that there are 200 people already pre-registered for the school at that conference? I mean, that's what the note says.
We've got no reason not to believe it.
Yeah. If that's true, you're going to have a busy school, aren't you? So all of these people are going to be graduating today. And I just want to say one last thing for all you soakers out there. Join us in September for that amazing conference, because it's going to be absolutely fantastic. So we want to give these folks quickly their graduation diplomas, and we're going to see how fast we can do this. But then after that, so steady yourselves for this part, right? I want you to come off the platform down to the front, and Carol and I and others are going to pray a prayer of impartation over you so that you will catch the fire and take it home. And when you pray for people in your little meeting, the very same thing that happens here is going to happen when you pray. Amen? Oh, goodness. Right. We had two of them wanting to share about the blessing that they experienced this week, and I think because of time, we'll just skip that. But they have some awesome testimonies of what God has done this week, and you can tell by looking at them that they're already half out of it anyhow, you know. So here we go. Deborah Kim, Jan Linton, Betty Burkholz, Christina Cancilla, Anita Kofu. All right. Can you give them their diplomas, please? How are we doing? Did we miss anybody? David Hampton, Jane Martin, Donna McGregor, Jim Nato. And after I call your name and give you your diploma, you can actually go down and stand at the front. Joan Schultz, Richard Sundberg, Doris Wilcox, Takato Namiki, Nabuko Nashitani. If I butcher your name, please forgive me. Anna Chea, Karen Van Sluis, Doreen McKercher, Roger Wells, Renetta Volker, Christina Paulson. All right. Sharon Cooper, Yvonne Fonten, Bernadette McNichols, Ruth Penman, Caroline Portsmouth, Daryl Richardson, Diana Stulnard, Daniel Allen, Mike Ayers, Amanda Becker, Ann Bell, Michelle Bellamy, and Laverne Burgess. Mark Collum, Georgianne Cole, Jane Cree, Marjorie Culhane, and Stephen Dewar. Clifton Elrod, Lucy Hood, Linda Howard, Sherry Laurie, Diane May, Roland Morris, and Marcia Mullen. Nancy Nyond, Jennifer Rigg, Marciano Salas, Margie Smith, Don St. Lucia, and Ginger Stevens. Tom Tiemens, Beadle Torres, Sophie Townsend, Jane Lynn Troxclair, Karen White, Susan Whitaker, Diane Zabrowski, and Marlene Norkin. And I must have missed a few. And whoever you are, you graduate as well. And we'll sort that out after. Right. Now what I need you to do is put your little toes on that green line, tighten up a little bit, move right around to both sides as much room as we can. I need a few more on that end, guys, if you could. Yeah. Now all of you, how many believe in impartation? I mean, I've had impartation several times in my life from dear men and women of God who have prayed for me. And every time it was amazing and a breakthrough. And the final piece for us was when Carol and I went to Argentina in November of 93, and Claudio Friesen prayed for us. And we received from him that came from heaven, a wonderful, glorious impartation of the Holy Spirit that changed our lives. We were hearing earlier today that you are one divine encounter away from breakthrough in the rest of your life. Just one powerful encounter with God the Holy Spirit will radically change your life. So can we stand and bless these people? Because they're going to go home and go for it. How many of you out there say, man, I want to go to one of those and get involved in this thing. Just give me a wave. Right. Well, you can pick up one of our soaking kits out there, take it home and get started and plan to come to one of our schools. But we want to pray a prayer of impartation for all of these people right now. Carol, where are you? There you are. All right. Can you stretch your hands toward them and start to say, Lord, let the fire of God fall upon these people in Jesus' name. Fire on him. Fire on him. Fire on him. Fire for Australia, Lord. Fire for Australia. Let it come in Jesus' name. Let it come. Let it come. Let it come. Lord, let fire come upon them. We give it to you. We give it to you in Jesus' name. We give it to you in Jesus' name for Japan. Let it come. Let it come. Oh, yeah, we give it to you here. We give it to you here in Jesus' name.
We give it to you here in Jesus' name. Lord, let the glory of God come right now. We give it to you. Yes, Lord, in Jesus' wonderful name. More power on them. Let power come upon them here. Let the glory of God come. What a holy moment, Father. In Jesus' name, we give it to you, Doreen. We give it to you here. Oh, Father, an impartation of heaven comes upon them now. Lord, when they go home, fresh fire on them as in their meetings, Lord, in their homes, in their churches, and wherever they go. Oh, Holy Spirit, let your glory come upon them. Let your peace, your heart, and your amazing passion just burn within them. In Jesus' precious name, oh Lord. In Jesus' precious name. Oh, Father. Fire on him here. Let it come, Lord God. Oh, Jesus. Oh, God. Increase it on her. Increase it on her. Oh, Lord God. Fresh on you. Fresh and holy fire burns on them. Increase it, God. Impartation. Impartation, Lord Jesus. Impartation on them, Father. Yes. Fill her up. Fill them up. Fill them up fresh, fresh, fresh. Yes, Lord God. Lord, we want to be bathed in the presence of the Holy Spirit. That's where the impartation comes. Oh, God, we give it to her. In the name of Jesus, we give it to you. We give it to you in Jesus' name. Fresh fire. Holy fire on you here. Let it come. Increase, 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 increase. A holy fire burns on you. A holy fire burns on you. We give it to you in Jesus' name. We give it to you in Jesus' name. Fresh on you. I'm not too sure if this is good. Yeah. Yeah. Father, we give you thanks for all of these. Fill her up, Lord. Set the earth on fire, Master, with your amazing love. That's our prayer. Oh, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it's my privilege tonight to introduce Bob Jones, who most of you have heard of, maybe you've never met before. So, Bob has an amazing prophetic gift. And he's going to come and share with us tonight. Bob, if you want to sort of tiptoe through the tulips there. And that's right. I think we can make that great. Carol and I went to see Bob about a year ago. And he had an amazing word for us just after we spent a whole, really a whole day with him. It was about 6 hours, I think, by the time that we were done. And he shared many, many things to us from his heart. And I'd like us to give him a great welcome tonight. So
Bob, it's all yours.
Thank you.
Keith, would you and Bobby and Steve, would you come up? I don't remember exactly when, but it was in the early 80s. And in a trance, the Lord told me that the greatest awakening would ever take place in this world would take place in the former Russian Empire. That what started there would invade Germany, the breakaway Muslim nations, and would go throughout the world. And that even some of them that would come out of Russia would come to the United States and would evangelize us. He also told me that the walls would come down in Russia. And it's in the 89 Shepherd Rod. And that out of that, the Jews would be able to go back to Israel. But he also said, as many Jews that went back to Israel, or as many Russians that would come out of the nation of Russia and learn and go back. So a lot of these indigenous plants have gone back to Russia. So I'm only saying this. These are records that are in several places. I brought these prophecies for a long time. So you that sow in to Russia, it's worthwhile. Anytime that I begin to bring a message, all I got to do is show up, be on time, and be empty-headed, and do what he tells me to do. So I thought I had things laid out till this morning. And I found out he's got some priorities he wants to do first. And I'm going to read you something. In Jeremiah 23:29, is not my word like fire that consumes all that cannot endure the test? Says the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks in pieces the rocks of most stubborn resistance. Well, he put a hammer in my hand this morning. And I'm part of the body of Christ. I've got the hammer. But if I'm only a part of the body of Christ, who all's got the hammer? Every one of you. And it's time that we begin to break off that stubborn resistance that's keeping us from receiving the blessing that God wants us to be blessed with. So I'm going to turn over to Deuteronomy and tell you what else he was speaking to me about the blessings. This hammer that he gave me, as soon as he gave it to me, I saw a huge rattlesnake. And he just crawled out of the woodwork. And the Lord says, let him have it. And I'm telling you, let him have it. The thing that's been rattling your mind and confusing you is a religious spirit. And it's time that you put the hammer on him. For what God's getting ready to do, if you know, I'd like for you to tell me. Because he says he's going to do it in a new way, and I've never even heard of it before, what he's going to do. He's going to be so far above what I would believe that he's not going to tell me until I build my faith up a little bit. You're the same way, because it's going to be a brand new thing. So what's been holding back the blessings? A religious spirit. James 3:16. Selfish ambition, bringing envy and jealousy and confusion in every evil work. What's been confusing you? You know what? It's been confusing the body of Christ. They're lazy. And they want a pattern and a formula that will work for them every time. And it only works in witchcraft. If you're going to work in God, it's going to be a brand new relationship and a brand new revelation every day. We should get our revelation every day, early in the morning and late at night. And if you seek Him, you will find Him. But patterns and formulas is where we can just go do something. Like a lot of time, people just give their money to this charity, that charity, or something like that. And you don't pray about where you should give it. I'm telling you, pray about Russia. I'm not telling you to give. I'm telling you, pray about it. Let the Holy Spirit of God tell you what to do. Then when you obey God, He'll bless you. So, I'm going to go in Deuteronomy 30:8. And you shall return and obey the voice of the Lord and do all His commandments, which I command you to do. He's saying, if you're going to obey me, then you're going to have to hear from me. You know, my greatest time would be, and I've already saw a lot of it here, is where I could come and bring you confirmation of what you've already got the revelation on. And I've heard it over and over here. It's time that the body of Christ grows up and begin to talk to their papa. And shut up to where he can talk back. And here's what he said he wanted to do today. And the Lord your God will make you abundantly prosperous in every work of your hands, in the fruit of your body, and of your cattle, and of the land for the good. For the Lord will again delight in prospering you as he took delight in your fathers. This is what he said he wanted to do. He wanted to bless you. He wanted a brand new day, and the first thing he said, I want to do is my people have curses over them. I want them broke off. And one of the main curses, he said, is their fishing net's been cursed to where they're not catching any fish. And I think it's more than just the devil and the new age and things like that. I think the jealousy of the church against one another has been cursing one another's fishing net. You know, obedience. How hard is it to be obedient? How hard is it to obey all the laws, statutes, and ordinances of God? Romans 13:10 is a four-letter word. That's all you got to do. If you love, you're obeying all of it. If you love, then you can hear. And so he's saying it's time I want to bless. And the first thing I saw was fishing nets. It's like, you may be surprised, but not all churches want to grow. And they sure don't want them growing in their neighborhood. And so there's been all kind of spoken words against the fishing nets. I know that many of you aren't from Canada, but I'm not talking about Canada. I'm talking about the worldwide church. And I'm putting a hammer in your hand tonight. And I'm saying, break the curses off the fishing nets where the souls that God's called to come in are coming in. For there's going to be 1 billion youth come in the last day, and it's time it starts. And he's saying, break the curses off, and that's what we're going to do, is begin to break the first of the curses off. And I'd like for you to get up here and share what you can and begin to break it over Canada and the rest of us to begin to break it over the United States and other parts. For we've talked about this, and you know Break it, not off of only the fishing nets in the church. Break it off of nature. Begin to bless the seas again so they can reproduce. Break the curses off the barrenness of the seas. Off the this is a blessing here. And these curses is shutting up everything down here now because of the curse on the land, the curse on the cattle, everything here in this scripture. So would you use that hammer to break these things?
I can do that. Shall I tell them the two things we're talking about?
Yeah.
When Bob mentioned to me tonight about fishing nets, he said, what does that mean to you? And I said, well, in Canada, two things real quick. In Canada, the Aboriginal people, the First Nation peoples, are allowed to use fishing nets where every other cultural group has to use a fishing rod. And so they have rights to fish out of season anytime they want and can catch far more fish. And so many people have felt that that is wrong and obviously would have cursed First Nation people. The other thing is on the east coast of Canada is perhaps the greatest fishing banks in the world, and the best codfish and halibut and those kind of things. And Canadians, fishermen, are only allowed to fish one day a year because other nations have come into those fishing banks and so overfished that the Canadians are saying to the Canadian fishing industry, you cannot do that because it'll just eradicate all the fish. And so on the east coast of Canada, there has been a lot of, Canadian fishing boats have gone out and tried to run in other boats and cut their nets and
robbery.
All those kind of things. Exactly.
That's what he was saying today. You've been robbed. Now, we're talking about Canada here, but some of you from other nations, you've been robbed too.
Yep.
Use that hammer. Patterns and Farmers are not going to work, but sonship is. Relationship is. So begin to bless the land. Bless the seas.
Yep.
You too. You out there from other nations, get up and begin to bless.
Where's the First Nation people that are here? If you're a First Nation person, could you stand up? Because Bob, that's in his heritage as well. That's in my wife's heritage. If you have First Nation heritage, could you stand up?
For you're the keepers of the land.
Let's speak a blessing over them right now. Father, we're asking in the name of Jesus that every person that's standing in the different cultural groups that they represent, Inuit, First Nation peoples, Father, all around the world, we bless these people in the name of Jesus. Father, we forgive us for cursing these people. Forgive us for taking things that were first theirs and now treating them with contempt. Holy Spirit, would you forgive us? Are there people from the east coast of Canada that are here? Could you stand up as well? East coast of Canada. That your heritage is Newfoundland, Prince Edward Island, Nova Scotia, New Brunswick. Father, we're asking that you'd forgive us as well for the anger that has been against other nations that have come in and robbed the livelihood of the fishing industry of the east coast of Canada. Father, would you forgive us for that? Would you forgive us for acts of violence, for curses that have been spoken against other nations? Father, Canada has cursed nations like America, Japan, Spain, France, other nations like that because of the overfishing. And Father, we're asking that you'd forgive us for doing that. Father, all the things that we have actually, by making vows and judgments against others, we've reaped that ourselves. And Father, we're saying in the natural, it's a foretaste of in the spirit realm. And Father, we're choosing to forgive, and we're choosing to have the waters restored in Canada, all around the world. Father, we're asking, restore them. Father, we take that hammer right now. Could you pick up a hammer in your hand and just beat something over the head right now? Father, we beat robbery over the head. We beat prejudice over the head. We beat injustice over the head. We just knock the life out of those things, Father, and we say every plan of the enemy dies right here, and blessing returns to your people. Jealousy against other churches, jealousy against other denominations, jealousy against other cities. Father, we break that in the name of Jesus. We hammer that to death in the name of Jesus, we pray.
Good. All right. You may be seated. Having worked with Bob for 12 years or so, I really understand his language, and I know when he sees things in the spirit like this, you know, sometimes how to apply it. Not always, but most of the time how to apply it. But so I'm just going to kind of ground this a little bit before we move on to the next round. But one of the things that he has seen, what Bobby has seen, what we're seeing, is that we're in a time of change. We're in a shift. We're a transition, an escalation. Water's going from the ankle to the knees, or if you're already at the knees, from the knees to the loins, there's just a shift and a change. And there has been a preparation that is essential to get there. I mean, that we have to be prepared for it. And one of the things he saw this morning, he saw a rattlesnake. Much of the things that Bob sees comes in the form of symbolism. And we need to understand the language of the spirit. And that spirit that he was seeing, represented by the rattlesnake, I've seen very often myself. And it's a religious spirit. It's a foul, mean, religious spirit that will do everything he can to keep you from going to the next new thing. He'll use accusation. He'll even use the reverse psychology. He'll say, oh, you're in such a good flow. Don't leave this flow. Don't leave this anointing. And he'll try to keep you here when the Lord wants you over here, right? The cloud's moving. And we cannot stay stationary. So what the Lord is giving to us tonight, what he's giving to you, because the Lord has made it clear that it's going to take a consolidated faith. The people that are speaking and the people that are listening, our faith joined together as one, Romans 1:11, a consolidation of faith to bring a spiritual impartation, but to say that we're not going to be subject to a religious spirit. We're not going to be subject to a spirit that masquerades as the Holy Spirit. That's what it does. Didn't Lucifer himself say, I will be like the Most High? He'll try to emulate in every way, and he'll try to use every means possible, because the enemy is desperate to keep God's people from moving in to maturity. Because when that happens, his kingdom is coming down. This whole thing is about dominion. It's all about dominion. So this word that was being given to us tonight is a word that shatters the house of cards. This thing that masquerades. Do you understand that now? Do you understand where, you know, you might say, well, I'm not here. Well, it doesn't matter if you're here. This is a corporate word, and it's also a regional word for this fellowship right here. But it's true corporately. Most every place we have been, people that have been groomed and prepared are positioned to move forward into this new anointing, this new release of heaven. It's going to be fantastic. It's going to be evangelistic, but it's much more than evangelistic. It's harvest. And harvest is bigger than evangelism, as important as evangelism is. It's about harvesting promises. How many of you in this room like to harvest a few promises? I can tell you, I'm in that group. It's about harvesting anointings. There have been promises and anointings given to other people, and those people perhaps have gone on, and that mantle, if we can use that language, is available. But a religious spirit is using every means possible to keep you from apprehending that mantle. See, that's what it will do. And the Lord said it's the restoration of all things. It's every anointing, every mantle, every promise. There are people that pressed through and obtained a promise from God. And many have never seen the promise fulfilled. And how many of you know the Lord never reneges on a promise? Never. Even if the person has died and gone to heaven, that promise will be fulfilled. I write about this on Bob himself in my book, Books of Destiny. He went to heaven. The enemy killed him on August 8, 1975. And Bob stood before the Lord Jesus while his body was on the earth, dead. He was in heaven, face to face with the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Lord said, I'm going to make you a promise. You're going to raise up a body of leaders that will see 1 billion souls come into my kingdom. That's a promise. See, that's what that's all about. And there are people who are about to apprehend those promises. Abraham was in the bosom of Abraham. He was in paradise 400 years. And the Lord, as if he woke up from a slumber, Psalm 105, I believe, said, oh, I remember my promise to my servant Abraham. And we're about to transition into that, and we cannot allow that religious spirit to keep us from harvesting every one of these things. Because it is about souls, but it's more than that. It's about harvest. Harvesting sons and daughters of God. So I just want to pray one more prayer as we shift and make sure you understand that. Understanding is a key that launches us into faith. So what I want you to do is just for a moment, just bow your head and close your eyes just for a moment, because this is applying to everyone in this room. But there are also some very direct implications to the very spot that we're standing on right here, right now. So, Lord Jesus, we agree with heaven. We agree with you, Lord. We agree with you in every aspect of the word. We want to follow the cloud. We're asking, Lord, that you give us keen discernment to understand the ways of God, the times of God, the seasons of heaven that are being released in this hour. And we say no to every religious spirit, every voice of accusation. We say no. Every persecuting voice, no. No more. No more to steal. No more to devour. No more. No more. And so, Lord, we ask that you release a rebuke against the devourer on our behalf, that we may restore everything that has been stolen. Lost finances, let them be restored. Lost relationships, let them be restored. Lost anointings, restored. Lost gifts, restored. Grant it, Lord. Let this word shatter every obstacle, every hindrance. Lord, go before us and behind us and battle on our behalf. Send out the warring angels, those that destroy, those that destroy and make a way where there is no way. Grant it, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Stay here with me, why don't you, Keith? Keith is already touching on some of the other stuff. Now, this witchcraft is controlled down here and spoken words over your body out of the past. Some of you got spoken words that go all the way back to when you were just a little child, spoken by people that had authority over you. And those curses are still hanging over you today. And one of the things that it'll do, it'll destroy your health. For those that had authority over you, speak words over you that are actually curses, like saying you'll never amount to anything. Someone say you'll never be healthy. These are lies, but they have a power in the spoken word. And one of the things that he said it was doing with several of you, how many of you recently, just raise your hand, have been dizzy, feeling a dizziness come on you? Well, what he was saying today, this is nothing but witchcraft and the power of the spoken word over your lives. Others have had control spirits spoke over you by people you trust. And one of the strongest things going on that is so bad up here is there's more divining than there is prophecy. There's so much divining up here that's coming out of the soul instead of the spirit that so few people would even believe true prophecy anymore because of this divining spirit. So every one of you that's had this control over you, that's had this spirit of heaviness over your chest, and this is the way it feels, or you just feel dizzy at times, especially when something spiritual is really going on. This is the thief and the robber that's been coming at you. Also, these spoken words have an ability to affect this thing up here that controls the natural health of your body. So in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I break these spoken words over my brothers and sisters. I break these spoken words over the body of Christ. Some of you just take a deep breath. For it's a time of liberty. Where the Spirit of God is, there is liberty. Where the Holy Spirit is God, there is liberty. So what the enemy's been trying to do is keep you from recognizing who the real God down here is. It's the Holy Spirit. And he's the only one who can present you to Christ. He's the one that's led you to salvation. And what he's saying tonight, I want you free. I want the only person that's controlling your life in any way will be me, and I'm growing you up to where you'll look like Jesus. So let this dizziness that's been coming at them, that's been coming at their soul, I break every spoken word that's ever been spoken to them. I break every curse that's ever been spoken over their life. For what the enemy's been doing is cursing the body of Christ. and keeping them weak to where they couldn't hear the things that God wants them to do. And God wants to bless. He's not cursing. He's going to bless his body, and especially his son's body. And this night, we bless the body of Christ with a new liberty and a new freedom and a new ability to let the Holy Spirit then begin to direct and motivate their lives. In Jesus' name. Now, some of you that has had some pretty bad headaches, just keep it up. Take some deep breaths. For that's what's been coming at you. This thing stirs the mind up. It makes you dizzy. It distracts you. And it'll really try to kill you if you're driving. So let the mind be free so we can have the peace of God and a new security. Good. Good. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Good. Oh, there's something very, very powerful about words. The Bible says this: the power of death and life is in the tongue.
Yeah.
The Apostle James says, you can train big horses, you can steer mighty ships, but the tongue. I'm telling you, this planet we're living on was created by a spoken word. What we need to learn is Isaiah 54:17. No weapon formed against you works. And every tongue that rises up against you, you have the commission of God to condemn it. Isn't that amazing? We can turn it back. And I want to tell you something. Here's what God wants to leave with us. He wants us to understand we need to start speaking great things over our own life. The Bible said, let the weak now declare, I am strong. We need to start saying that over our own selves. Let the weak now declare, I'm strong. And you know what else he says? One of my favorite verses is a little verse tucked away in Micah 3:8. It says this: but truly I am full of power by the Spirit of the Lord. But truly I am full of power by the Spirit of the Lord. See, if we start reciting that and recording that into the atmosphere, the devil will believe it. The devil will believe it. He only moves by what he hears. Isn't that amazing? I want to tell you something. Here's what God's longing for us to do. 2 Corinthians 7:1.
Yeah.
It's a big thing right now. 2 Corinthians 7:1 says, dearly beloved, most precious loved ones, having therefore these dynamic, precious promises, let us purify ourselves from every bit of the contamination of the spirit and of the flesh, perfecting in ourselves the reverential, holy will of God. Listen, guys, God wants us to, one translation says, we have got to get this thing right, bringing our consecration to completeness. Now, there is a promise right now hanging over our head that's going to promote purity like you've never seen yet in the body of Christ. Having therefore these precious promises, what promise is it? It's the promise found in 2 Corinthians 6, being identified as the true sons and daughters of Almighty God. Isn't that amazing? We need to get it clear who we are. We're children of the King. We're destined for success. One of my favorite verses is Jeremiah 29:11. Here's what he said. I know my thoughts I have towards you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of your peace, thoughts of your safety. I intend to bring you to a good end, not a dismal demise. Jeremiah 31:17 says, I will bring you to a future filled with bright hope. Now, I'll tell you, since all these calamities and all these tragedies have been falling upon the earth, they seem almost relentless. You can't believe the people that call the prophets and go, what does the future hold? Some are saying, do we even have a future? Now, here's the wise prophet. The wise prophet will not try to just tell people what the future holds, but the wise man and woman of God will tell the world who holds the future. Amen. See, this thing's in God's hands. And what we've got to do is realize he's in control. Isaiah 26:3, God will do something. He will keep us in what? Perfect peace. When our mind is stayed upon the Lord. Trust in the Lord. For in the Lord, Jehovah is everlasting, never failing strength. So what are we going to have to do? Force our focus on the Lord. Isaiah 26:3, thou will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on the Lord. Trust in the Lord Jehovah, for in the Lord Jehovah is everlasting, never failing strength. So we have to watch our words, pack our heart full of the Word of God. You know what's going to happen? Prayer's about to move from a plea to a proclamation. From, oh God, could you? Oh God, would you? To where we begin to declare the will of God. Remember 1 John 5:14? This is the confidence that we have in Him. That if we ask Him anything according to His will, we know that He hears us. If we know that He hears us, we know. We have absolute confidence that we have what we're asking Him for. So prayer is going to move from a plea to a proclamation. Somewhere I read, concerning the works of my hands, command ye thou me. Oh, here's my verse for you, and then I'm through. It's Job 22:27. Come on, bring your prayers to the Lord. And then verse 28. If it wasn't in this book, I wouldn't believe it. Job 22:28. Here's what it says. You ready? Decree a thing, and what you decree will be established. Decree a thing. Decree a thing, and what you decree will be established. You say, oh, well, that's just a little obscure verse over there in the Old Testament. Jesus said exactly, precisely the same thing in Mark 11:21-24. Whatsoever things you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you'll have them. And then he said, oh, I love this. Have you read it? Matthew 11. And you can say to this mountain, not doubt in your heart, you will have whatsoever you saith. Now, I quote that in the North American church where we're at right now. And guess what I feel? I feel people going, what? That's that Kenneth Copeland stuff. You know what I tell people? I believe Jesus said it before Kenneth. Guys, we better learn what's ours. We better learn. Listen, this is last will and testament. This is what belongs to us. And we need to start bringing it back to Father and say, Lord, your word said. And we start declaring back to him what he promised. We'll get it. But I'm here to tell you, your words are much more powerful than you think. Now, every time Jesus was attacked by the devil, he retaliated with one thing. It is. Now, do you believe right now today we need to understand what's written? There's a great attack. The first time the devil ever spoke to man, what did he say? Hath God said. He's still saying the very same thing today. Look at the Da Vinci Code. That's still an echo of has God said. Guys, we better find out what God says and start moving along that line. God bless your heart.
That's what I come up here for.
Oh.
You better learn the word.
Better learn the word is right.
Is there anybody out here that ever did any boxing in a ring? I want to teach you young ladies how to fight. Yeah.
I'll leave it with you.
If you were boxing, that's what he's talking about. If you're boxing, you keep the left hand out in front of you. For it's what protects you. And you never use the right hand. Because when you get a chance to use the right hand, you take your enemy out all the way. All the way down to the hip, the commitment. So, it's time that you young ladies learn to fight with us boxers. A boxer if the enemy gets too close at him, he covers himself. He protects himself. Would y'all like scripture on this? I wouldn't bring it if it wasn't in here. 2 Corinthians 6:7. By speaking the word of truth in the power of God with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand to attack. And the left hand to defend. So how do you defend yourself? Like Bobby said, it is written. Quoting the written word of God keeps the devil off of your back. When you get under attack, just keep punching him and keep him away from me. The Logos. Greater is he that's in me than he's in the world. The Lord Jesus is for me. He's not against me. This is how you keep him at bay. And then after a while, something happens that gets from here down to here. Greater is the Lord that's in me than he is in the world. You take him out. You can totally take him out with the Rhema word of God. The right hand is the faith. You have to hold it until you get permission or until you get an inspiration in you. And then what Bobby said is proclaim it. You get an inspiration in you, don't ask again. Proclaim it. Let it become creative. The two enemies you fight against are patterns and formulas. In the original vision ahead of this, the Lord put me in a boxing ring with two of the biggest bruisers you ever saw. And they were huge. They were four stories high. And I'm thinking, the Lord's behind this. I may get bowled over, but I'm going to go down fighting. And in the original vision, a little 11-year-old girl come in, and she says, Bob, I'll help you. And she had a pen. She walked up to this pattern, and she popped him, and whew, it was like a hot air balloon. Then she walked up to the formulas, went right back up to where they come from. These things is withstanding the body of Christ is nothing but hot air of the devil. And we need childlike faith to begin to... All it takes is just one little pinprick. We've got to learn to fight. And we're going to have to fight before you got any victories. And you're going to have to learn the Logos word of God before you can start quoting it. Start eating it. Then it'll start working in you. I don't think the body of Christ really knows who they are. I'm going to try to show you a few things that says who you are. If you know who your daddy is, you know who you are. I'm in the Amplified, in case you didn't know it. And I'm going with the 23rd verse. You have been regenerated, 1 Peter 1:23. You have been generated, born again, not from a mortal original seed sperm, but from one that is immortal by the ever-living and everlasting word of God. Who's your daddy? When you were born again, that seed came right in with your conception, not at birth. The only thing that has this seed is man. All men, which were both women and men, because of their ancestor, Adam, God breathed his spirit into him. That's that God's sperm seed. And your DNA is like this, this, this. All these things are DNA. But it's not your genetics. Man is the only living thing in all the universe that's got that God sperm seed, that genetics. A man has a choice because of that seed of who he will serve. Many let that seed return to the Father without ever opening. Others, now it's time that the shift comes and that seed will open. And the only thing that pleases Papa, it has to look like his son. But in every one of you, that seed looks just like his son. And you've already opened up and born again. Let the Holy Spirit water that and nurture that until you grow up. Now, there is some that's growing up now in the body of Christ. I have seen, Keith and I, we saw a few years ago that the genetic strands was like whorls. And I've seen recently the Lord is snipping a few of the weak whorls out of it and replacing new genetics that'll never die. We're in a time of change. And if we take on the genetics of our Papa and we grow up, you know what would please him the greatest? If you growed up and began to speak like his son. You saw a miracle up here where a lady's leg came out. You know, his son could speak into the DNA of things and change it. There is a generation that will grow up in his presence, and they will speak, proclaim, and that DNA will come together, new arms and new legs. By the way, it's already happening on the inside of bodies. We see these creative miracles now. And he hadn't started on the outside yet because you've got to grow up for it. The worst thing that could happen is one man be doing it. It's got to be the body now. The body of Christ has got to rise up and become the body of Christ. I got the hammer because I'm part of it, but you do too. You got the same genetics that I have. Let's grow up and begin to do the greater works, because that's what our brother wanted, is grow up and do the greater works. Can you imagine the problem with 3,000 Jesuses walking around? Speaking and proclaiming things, breaking every curse. Going on, ceiling. 1 Peter 2:2. Like newborn babes, you should crave, thirst, earnestly desire the pure, unadulterated spiritual milk. It's time that we begin to let the Holy Spirit nurture us into maturity. And the Holy Spirit has been grieved because we haven't allowed him the lordship that he should have over our lives so he can present us to Christ. The spiritual milk, that by it you may be nurtured and grow into complete salvation. A complete salvation, spirit, soul, and body. There's a younger generation that I've known for a long time that's not even called to the grave. They're called a relationship. And intimacy with Papa. Moses would never die unless God killed him because he spent so much time with the Lord. There's a young generation, and our job or mine is to bring it into being. Help them grow up. Get behind them. Oversee them. And stay out in front of them. And the ones that he's really calling to do this is the over 50s. The over 50s has got a job now like there's been no other opportunity before in history. To get behind this younger generation, it's going to lead 1 billion souls to the Lord. What's the purpose of growing up? In the third verse, since you have already tasted the goodness and kindness of the Lord, you're already saved. Let's go on with that salvation, because when a baby is born, he's here. Let's get out of the diapers. Let's get potty trained. And let's go begin to do the stuff in a bigger way. Now, I have saw recently the glory of God is returned to the body. Get ready for the glory. Get ready for the shining. Get ready for the signs and wonders. I'm going over to John 2, 10 and 11. And I'm going to show you where I believe my daddy had some great disappointments. And I'm going to show you where the shift is right now. And said to him, everyone else serves the best wine first. But when the people have drunk freely, and then he served that which is not so good, but you have kept back the good wine until now. I don't believe you've seen anything yet. I think you're getting ready to see the wine of the Holy Spirit, or what y'all had here, I think, is going to be like kindergarten to what you're going to have. I mean, this is the best wine he's talking about. So this best he saved until now. I'll go with 11. This was the first of his signs, miracles, wonder work, and Jesus performed in Cana in Galilee and manifested his glory. But he displayed the greatness of his power openly, and his disciples believed in him, adhered to, and trusted in, and relied on him. This word first here means arch. You're getting ready to start your arch. Then come back down with it. Relationship. Jacob's ladder. Open portal, open heaven. I wonder what y'all will look back when he really gives you the new wine. The very best. That's creative wine. You understand what I'm trying to talk about? This was created out of water. What are y'all going to do with the creative power? Or, I hope you're hearing what I'm saying. This is the best wine. You got good healings here. But you got the best wine coming that'll like a marriage wine, like a being covenanted together. Where you don't talk against one another, you don't destroy one another, you don't curse one another, you bless one another, and in that blessing it's creative. Yep. Now I'm going to turn over to Deuteronomy 5:24. And I really feel that this is what it's all about. My papa had a really strong discouragement in the past. And when you heard the voice, I'm in 23, Deuteronomy.
5:20. And then when you heard the voice in the midst of the darkness while the mountain was burning with fire, you came near me and all the heads of your tribes and your elders, and you said, behold, our God has shown us his glory and his greatness, and we've heard his voice out of the midst of the fire. We have this day seen that God speaks with man, and man yet still lives. But now, therefore, why should we die? For this great fire will consume us if we hear the voice of God, our God, any longer. We shall die. I'll tell you, that was Papa's greatest disappointment in mankind. For he wasn't calling Moses to be the only one. He was calling all Israel. He's calling every one of you. What's in you? It doesn't make any difference what age you are. A baby can still cry out to their papa and hear from him. My daddy is big enough to have what he wants in this last day. And what he wants is a people that'll talk to him and listen to him. My daddy's a family man. He never meant for one man to do all the talking. He meant for his son's body to do it. The shift is, if you're an observer, you better find a real quiet place, because what's going to happen is participators. Every one of you have called to participate in what he's doing through hearing. A shift has taken place. I'll try to come at it from another direction now. One thing he was saying, a couple of years ago, I saw the incubators of heaven. They had 3,000 eggs in the incubators. And the Holy Spirit was brooding over them like he did in Genesis 1. When he brooded over the waters, he's brooding over the body of Christ again. And I saw those eggs and I said, oh boy, the heavens will shortly be full of eagles. Well, people like me don't know everything. Recently, he began to tell me they weren't eagles. They're doves. I have a First Nation blanket hanging on a balcony like that in my house. On March the 17th, something happened to that red birthing blanket. It got full of dove feathers. I mean, hundreds and hundreds of them, where I've already given hundreds away. They're taped in a lot of Bibles, different places. I begin to understand what he's talking about then. The eagles you already got. They already, you eagles, you're out there. But what's going to happen now, and what's coming out of the shell, the hard shell, is doves. The cocoon of the anointing that's breaking off of doves. Ezekiel 36, 26. 25 is like the water brooding over the water, over the doves again, to bring forth Ezekiel. 26, which is a new heart. A brand new heart. A heart that has a papa and knows what their DNA is. If you know your, you know, you're the result of your parents. I'll tell you something else that I just learned. The blood that comes in conception doesn't come from the mother, it comes from the father. When the Holy Spirit come to Mary, it had none of her blood in it. It had the blood of Papa in it. And that's what he wants now, that the blood of Jesus in you would come forth in a new purity. The mother, there's a really need for the mother church to feed the babies, to nurture them, to cleanse them. But that God sperm seed is coming forth is pure in you. To bring forth a generation that'll change. I mean, they're going to change the world. And does it need it? So what's being birthed are doves. He came as a dove. He came in weakness so that the Holy Spirit and his Father can show strength to him. Some of you have been brought to be doves. In Romans 16:20, a dove represents peace. In Romans 16:20, it isn't the God of war that subdues Satan there. It's the God of peace that puts him underneath your feet. You know what Papa's talking about with these doves? You'll have the authority as this dove to put Satan underneath your feet. You know what a peacemaker is? Matthew 5:9. Bobby's already touched on it. They're sons. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they are the sons of God. These doves are sons and daughters of God. And where they walk, they're going to take the land. They're going to subdue the enemy because they've got peace. They've got peace like a river that cannot keep from flowing. And it'll overflow the banks of all the nations of this world. And there's a generation that's coming now that's not going to be afraid. And I've already told you, there's a generation coming out of Russia. And they're going to get a hold of the Lord Jesus Christ. And they'll go and evangelize the entire world over there and wind up evangelizing it. But you have youth here that need the same vision. Without a vision, the people perish. Without a vision, there is no restraints to this thing here. But with a vision, this thing here's got an anchor in it that keeps us in peace. Our soul is anchored in Christ. And it has that blessed hope of Christ. So I'll tell you, we're in a time that you're going to see a lot of insanity. For the world is losing its hope. When you lose your faith, the next thing to go is your hope. And whenever you lose your hope, it's the last thing to die. If you have not hope and no vision, then it's an unrestrained, a suicidal generation. You are that anchor and you're the hope for those that's yet to be saved. But the doves are what's going to do it. The doves are the ones that are going to touch it. I've studied some of the scriptures on this dove. I've got 125 of them written down here. I'm not going to share all of them. So if you want to know, then don't be lazy. Go find out the same way I did. But you're going to have to get into the Word. For the Word is what you need, the Logos Word of God. And as you
punch it out in the devil's face long enough, it'll sink from here to here. And when it gets in the spirit man, it's got power in it. You haven't seen anything yet. There's at least 3,000 in the first hatching. And these hatchings are going to go on and on and on. And they're going to reproduce. The dove is a sacrifice for the poor. God has got his visions on the poor. A lot of your wealth is not going to change. But they're sure going to be unhappy. But the poor is ready to be saved. It's time that we become a sacrifice, a living sacrifice for the poor nations on this earth. For it is a time of the snow white dove. And it is a time that he's given supernatural signs like these feathers. And I believe he put it on my First Nation blanket. I believe it represents a real call into the First Nation, but I really feel it's a more than that. It's a call into his First Nation people. I believe that the entire church is getting ready to become the church, which is his First Nation people, and the first church or his First Nation is those that will seek his voice and obey. It's one thing even to hear his voice, and it's another thing to obey. I believe that we're coming into time to where these doves will not only hear, in their weakness, God will show himself strong in their behalf. I believe it's in their weakness that doors will open throughout the entire world. And a lot of youth, I think you're going to see coming here in your future, is from other nations. You'll train them and send them back as indigenous plants. When they go back to their nation, they'll be natural to that. And they'll take back that anointing they get here in other places. But I know one thing. You're getting ready for the best wine. And the best of times. You're getting ready for a party. Well, I'll tell you something about Jesus. He didn't have a sour disposition. He was a party person. And I think he's ready for a party. And I think he's ready for the entire body of Christ to enjoy him and party with him. I think it's time that loneliness and rejection and everything that's been destroyed in the body of Christ, that this hammer kills it. And that we come forth in the joy of the Lord. We come loaded in the Holy Spirit, loaded for bear. And bear to me means fear. That we come loaded, and we come loaded for any bear that shows up. We'll use him as a bear rug. But the shift has taken place. Now, grow up. I've got more faith in you than you have in yourselves. Because I come back from death to see you get your act together. So get it together. And let's begin to bring in the harvest. It's out there. It's not in here. It's out there. Let's start bringing it in. I'll not stand before the Lord and look in his eyes again and asked him why it didn't happen. I totally have lived a life to see it happen. I will see it happen. I'm not going to the grave until I see it happen. So get on the stick and let's get it going. Use that hammer to destroy anything that's been holding you back. If you're thinking, and the way you think of yourself been holding back, use that hammer on it. For most of your thinking is what's holding you back. Use that hammer, that word of God, and quote what he says about you in here. You've already heard what he thinks about you. Your sons, your daughters, you were created to have a relationship with your daddy, your family. He loves you. He's already showed all of that. He's told you what his thoughts are to you. Quote them things when rejection and these things come at you and depression. When depression comes at you, you know what I do? You will not steal my day. I reckon I have the say, and we are not going to go and have a bummer day. We're going to have a good day. For this is the day my daddy made. And I simply refuse to be depressed. I simply refuse to be defeated. I can't be defeated. Because my enemies is defeated already. I believe it. Therefore, he's defeated. I get out of my way. I'm going for a walk. For I'm a peacemaker, you see. I'm far more powerful than the enemy. For the guard of the Lord, it dwells in me. When I walk down the path and him I do see, one of us is going to give way and it's not going to be me. So you aren't wearing me, you see, because I got a big brother that's right behind me. And he's already seen to you and put you to shame before all to see. Because my big brother, he loves me. Yes, he loves me. So does my daddy. I've got this settled, you see. And when I get it settled between these ears, it's settled continually, it's settled for all eternity. For that's the last place it's going to be settled. And it's settled in me this day. Lord bless.
Did you want to pray a blessing over people? And then we'll have the prayer ministry team.
Now, when you see me do this, this is just exactly what the strands of DNA looks like. So let whatever need they have, let this DNA come into their bodies, into their spirits, into their soul, and replace whatever's needed. And let them go forth in a new faith to begin to declare the power of their daddy and begin to speak that DNA into places that it hasn't been for a long time. Let now the Spirit of God that reigns over their lives bring them to a place where the shift can begin and the doves can take the authority that's needed over all the lands. And let the wind that's blowing over them now be the angels that continually go with them to every nation that they go to this day. In Jesus' name, now let it be. Amen.
Wonderful. I'd like you to stand up, please. Let's stand. I just really feel tonight that what Bob has been saying and what the other men have been preaching is about something needs to get in each of us tonight. Something needs to get in us. And there's a lot of different ways that things get in us. But one of the primary ways in which stuff was put into other people in the Bible was through the laying on of hands. And I haven't figured out how it works in the math and physics and things like that. But I just know in the scriptures that when Peter and John visited a church and laid their hands, that the Holy Spirit was imparted. And even a sorcerer, a former sorcerer, was so astounded. He was used to magic. He was used to witchcraft. He was used to all sorts of occultic things. And when he saw this impartation, when he saw this, he was willing to buy it, wasn't he? And in the scriptures, it talks about how the Holy Spirit is able to go from one person into the life of another person. And in one sense, it doesn't make sense. And yet in another sense, it makes absolute sense. Because the Holy Spirit that's in me wants to shake hands with the Holy Spirit that's in you. And wants to greet the Holy Spirit in you. And it's our privilege to lay hands on you tonight. Every single person who would like to have someone just to say, Father, come and put something better in, put something new in, put something deeper in. And if you're up for that, that's what we're going to be praying tonight. I'd like all of you that are on the prayer ministry team, if you could either come to the front or if you could get into the aisles. Everyone else, if you could just sort of stay right in your chair right now, please. But those of you on the prayer ministry team, if you could get into... What I'd like you to do, actually, have a seat, folks. That's the best thing. What we need you to do is we need about 150 people that would volunteer to be catchers for our prayer ministry team. So prayer ministry team, could you put your hand up? Now, here's the deal. Friends, if you could come and help these people, they're not allowed to minister unless there's someone to be with them. And prayer team, as soon as someone's come to be with you, could you go to the designated area where you're going to be going to? Those of you that are underneath the flags, could I get you to folks to stand up and begin to stack your chairs? Those of you in the back area, could I get you to stand up and stack your chairs against the sides and get ready? Let's do this real quiet, but we need about another 100 people just to run up, find someone with their hand up and say, I will help you. And prayer team, if you'll brief them, and then right away, if you'll go to your areas. Now, friends, those of you that are going to be ministered to, just stay right in your chair because the prayer team need to get to their areas, and many of them need to go upstairs. So let them get upstairs before you go so that they can get themselves organized. Again, prayer team, get ready to go to your area as soon as someone comes to help you. Find someone with their hand up. Lots of people over here. Prayer ministry team, those of you that are going upstairs, if you'll make your way very quickly upstairs.
School of Ministry, if you could just give me your attention. When you're done praying underneath the flags, can you then just go and help at the back? Because I think we might need a bit there.
Okay, it looks like we still need about another 20 or so people to help our ministry team. And again, ministry team that are ministering upstairs, if you will go as quick as possible. So is there some more people that would be willing to help our prayer ministry team? If you'll run up to the front, just find these people with their hands up. Okay, those of you in this center section right here, those of you in this section right here, can I get you folks to head upstairs? You need, ladies, you need to take your purses with you. There are elevators by the ladies' washroom just down the aisle there, if you'd like to do that, or there's stairs. And if you'll head upstairs and in the upper rooms, there are There's lots and lots of room, and the prayer ministry team upstairs, they will be briefing you as to where to stand, but you're going to get in long lines. Those of you in this section over here, if you could, if there's not room back here, if you'll just maybe try to find some room at the back over here. And it's our privilege to pray for every single person. So prayer ministry team, we do need a few more catchers, maybe about another 10 people to be catching. So if you'd like to help, you just run up. You will not be missed. You will get lots of prayer ministry. There's some people underneath the flags that have their hands up. So if you'd like to help, you go ahead and do that. Those of you in this side section over here, if you can't find room here, there's room at the back, and we will be having two rows on the green lines that go from the stairs towards the resource center as well. One or two more catchers, if you could come to the front. Prayer team, keep your hand up so we can see where you are if you need someone to help you. Prayer ministry team, as soon as you are ready, you may begin to impart. And I want you to speak into people's lives and just do your best. If you feel that there's words from the Holy Spirit for that person, just speak life into them. Speak into their destiny. Speak a rising up. Speak a releasing of more. Speak a blessing. Speak whatever kind of things that the Holy Spirit has given to you, and just go ahead and do all that. Those of you in the that are going upstairs, head right into the upper rooms, head into the rooms upstairs, and there's lots of room there for you. Those of you upstairs, it looks like the upper rooms are closed, and someone's running up right now just to open those, so there'll be lots more room there. Prayer ministry team, you begin to release, begin to pray, begin to give away. Spirit of God, come. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. We welcome you. Just a reminder, when you leave tonight, when you go back to your chair, if you left a water bottle, if you left some Kleenex, if you could pick that up, put it in a garbage can, a trash container, make sure you take your belongings with you. The colors are going to be rotating tomorrow, and the blue color that were at the front today are going to be heading to the back, and everyone else moves forward one. The doors open at 8:30 tomorrow morning, so you're welcome to come at 8:30. First session is at 10. Intercession starts at 8:45. Folks, in this section over here, there is going to be two lines between the stairs and the resource center on the floor, so you can just find a spot in there. There should be two lines that are parallel to the stairs over to the resource center that have green lines, and just stand on those green lines. Those of you upstairs, you can head into the overflow rooms, onto the balcony level as well. Spirit of God, come.
Okay, those of you that are on the lines, I don't want you to be looking around wondering when your prayer ministry person's coming, okay? I want you to begin to hold your hands out to the Holy Spirit. Close your eyes and just focus on the Lord. and just wait for him, okay? Because it's, you know, the Holy Spirit is the one that comes and does the ministry. He just uses the people, so don't look for the person, okay? Just prepare yourself and just say, Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, I ask now that you would just come all over this place as we choose to stand and just receive all that you have for us, Lord. We thank you that tonight that we are freer people, that we are people of destiny, Lord. We thank you for all that you've done. And so, Holy Spirit, we stand and we wait for you to move in and out, Lord. You're all around us, all around us.
Time for the dead and gone. Time for the broken ones to live again. It's time for the dead to rise. Time for the wings to fly. To live again, I can hear it calling. I can hear the sound of rain. And over the mountains, over the valleys, I hear a calling. It's time. Songs of freedom. It's time for the numb to feel. Time for the wounds to heal. With songs of freedom, I can hear the calling. I can hear the sound of rain. Time for the tide to turn.
time for our hearts to burn with desperation. It's time for a sacrifice. Time that we pay the price for our generation. I can hear the calling. I can hear the sound of
Oh,
Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Keep coming. Spirit of God, keep coming. For those of you who have already had someone minister to you, that is not the end of ministry. That is the beginning. For those of you who have not had someone come and minister to you yet, don't be a spectator. Just close your eyes. Begin to welcome the Holy Spirit right where you are. Don't wait for another individual to come to you and activate things. You can do that by yourself and just say, come, Holy Spirit. And if you're sitting down, if you're lying down, you're standing up, wherever you are, just begin to ask and say, Father, come more. Come some more. Come and meet me again. Come and give to me more. Release into my life more. Holy Spirit, come. Come. If you are standing in one of the prayer lines at the back, upstairs, underneath the flags, and no one has come to you yet, could you put your hand up, please? No one has come to you yet. You're standing on one of the prayer lines. You need to be on one of the prayer lines if people are going to come to you. Put your hand up again. Prayer team, if you can look around in your area, please, where you are, and just try to get a sense of where the people are. Holy Spirit, come. Come. Prayer team, remember, you're not doing inner healing, you're not going real deep ministry, you're just praying in the Holy Spirit, giving away the Holy Spirit, giving away what you feel. After everyone in your area has been prayed for, then you can go back and do the deeper things if you're feeling to do that. But just remember, you're praying impartation, you're praying hope, you're praying life, you're praying hope, you're praying boldness, you're praying courage, you're praying all those good things into people. And release that into people. So Holy Spirit, just keep coming. Just keep coming. Just keep coming. Just keep coming, Holy Spirit. Come. Come.
Suddenly I feel you holding me. 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 I feel you.